Okay, welcome to, what is it, the desert of the real, I suppose, the waterless curtain hall. Thanks for coming out in the cold and dry, and glad to see people here. Before I briefly introduce Eleana Kim, let me just remind you that next Friday we'll be hosting the MLA subcommittee, a group of graduate students and adjunct faculty who are trying to make the MLA a more responsive organization than it is to the concerns of the increasing adjunctification of the profession. So there's a group of them who will be here for a couple of days working up in the center, and then they'll present a panel on their concerns next Friday at 3:30, and this is sort of in anticipation then of a conference that they'll be hosting right before the MLA and the 2 days before that. That's the Modern Language Association, for those of you not in the language business. Anyway, it should be a really interesting discussion about labor concerns in the academy. Also, we won't be having a reception today. We normally, as you know, do, but conditions make that impossible. So I'm really pleased to welcome Eleana Kim here. She received her PhD in anthropology from New York University in 2007. Eleana was an associate professor in anthropology and the graduate program in visual and cultural studies at the University of Rochester before joining the faculty at UC-Irvine this fall. She's now an associate professor in anthropology. She's received fellowships from the ACLS, from SHRC, Social Science Research Commission in Canada, the Fulbright Commission, and the Korea Foundation. Her research interests revolve around questions of nature and culture and the biological and the social in the production of personhood, social relations, and moral values. Her first book, Adopted Territory, Transnational Korean Adoptees and the Politics of Belonging, focused on identity, globalization, and the political economy of kinship. Her second book project, which really has marked a shift in direction of focus, although not in sort of geopolitical location, second book project, Making Peace with Nature, The Greening of the Korean Demilitarized Zone, analyzes the transformation of the most heavily militarized border in the world into a space internationally recognized as a haven for biodiversity. And today's talk, as you can see up on the screen, is Militarized Flyways, Migratory Birds, and Choreographies of Endangerment. So with that, Eleana, come on.
Hi, everyone. Can you hear me okay if I stand like this? Okay. Thank you very much to Richard Grusin, and all the fellows in the center, especially to Gloria Kim, and also to Emily Clark and Annette Hess. I'm very happy to be here and to share with you what are very much works in progress. And this paper in particular is not one that I imagined to be part of my book project, but as I started working on this paper, I thought, well, maybe it could be. So for that, I also thank you. As I was completing the paper, I got a Facebook announcement from Gloria about the upcoming conference Beyond Extinction that will be planned for this spring. So that also got me thinking, since in part this paper is also dealing with issues of extinction and particularly around an endangered bird species. So I was hoping that this paper could offer a bridge between the theme of the humanities futures of the center this year and also the exciting conference Beyond Extinction that's coming up in the spring. At the most basic level, this paper tells a story of extinction averted for now. From another perspective, it engages with futures by trying its hand at what Eben Kirksey, in a different context, calls hope in blasted landscapes, and what Celia Lowe referred to once as micro-utopias in a degraded world. In my larger project on the DMZ and its ecological value, I'm continually coming up against the depressing replay of all too familiar dynamics. elements of the organic world abstracted and objectified as pure nature and made ripe for neoliberal capture. As I discussed during the brown bag today, in the case of the DMZ, despite all evidence that points to the contrary, including the 1 million landmines, military infrastructures, and human activities, the story of it having returned to nature is widely promoted and increasingly folded into state branding mechanisms. The Korean DMZ is the world's most heavily militarized border and is often described in terrestrial terms as a no man's land. Uninhabited for 60 years since the end of the war, which was between 1950 and 1953, the DMZ has long represented for South Koreans the trauma of the national division. Over the past decade, however, as evidence of the zone's biodiversity has drawn the interests of scientists, environmentalists, state bureaucrats, and others, the DMZ is now increasingly associated with narratives of nature's resilience and symbols of peace and life. In this paper, I bring an ethnographic analysis to conservation of an endangered species associated with the DMZ area. In doing so, I hope to offer something beyond a critique of neoliberalization of the global environmental movement and the capitulation of conservation efforts to the financialization of everything. My approach is inspired by Bruno Latour's Compositionist Manifesto, in which he calls for an alternative to critique. This is not because critique has lost its luster, but because so much of the highly justified screeds against the neoliberalization of conservation leave us moored on the shore of Nature Inc., filled with righteous indignation, but not much imagination of what to do or where to go next. Can a humanistic social science find a way forward? I alternate between being cautiously hopeful and somewhat doubtful. Yet I'm continually inspired by the work of the naturalists, activists, and conservationists that I have met in South Korea and elsewhere, for whom the present is certainly bleak, but the horizon of possibilities is never entirely foreclosed. As an alternative to global environmental governance from Copenhagen to the 12th Convention on Biodiversity, which took place in South Korea, might we seek out different and unexpected compositions of space and time to move, as Latour suggests, not toward futures, but toward prospects? As he writes, in light of social and feminist studies of science, quote, we need to have a much more material, much more mundane, much more imminent, much more realistic, much more embodied definition of the material world if we wish to compose a common world. So in that spirit, I bring attention to the mundane, material, and artful modes of engagement among my ethnographic collaborators, following in a long tradition of anthropology as cultural critique, which in the age of the Anthropocene might take the form of anthropology as critically utopic, prospecting for sustainable futures. So with that, I'll begin with an origin story of sorts. This is Pyeongho Won, or Won Byung-ho, the founder of South Korean ornithology. He was born in 1929 in Kaesong, an ancient capital of pre-modern Korea that now lies north of the DMZ, which separates the two Koreas. Pyeongho's love of birds was nurtured by his father, Won Hong-woo, who was a prominent naturalist and bird researcher. The Korean War started shortly after the young Won had completed his university degree in agricultural sciences. And at his father's insistence, he and his two brothers headed south in 1950, leaving behind his parents and two sisters. After the war, Byung-ho continued his studies, earning a doctorate from Hokkaido University in Japan, and then returned to South Korea to serve on the faculty of Pyongyang University until his retirement in 1994. During that time, he was a key figure in establishing the natural sciences in South Korea and was responsible for identifying more than 50 new bird species. He's the author of more than 150 scholarly papers and dozens of birding manuals and general interest books, and he trained a generation of ornithologists in South Korea, earning him the nickname Dr. Bird. But what has made his biography so mythic, and the subject of a number of films and children's books, is how his love of birds, which was nurtured by his father, helped to overcome seemingly insurmountable political and geographic boundaries. In 1965, Dr. Won received a letter from the Asia headquarters of BirdLife International in Tokyo. Dr. Won in North Korea, received a letter from the Asia headquarters of BirdLife International in Tokyo informing him that a purple-backed starling that he had banded 2 years earlier, Dr. Won in South Korea received this letter, that he had, that the bird he had banded 2 years earlier in Seoul had been identified in North Korea. The person who had found the banded bird was none other than his own father. Due to the near impossibility of communicating between the two Koreas, neither father nor son had known during the intervening 15 years whether the other had survived the war. As the story goes, his parents treasured the aluminum metal band imprinted with the code C7655, weeping as they caressed it, missing their distant son. So on the top you can see a picture of the bird. I don't know if it's the actual bird, but in any case, below it is the metal band imprinted, and below is the older one. The history of ornithology in North and South Korea is thus intimately linked to the national division. In this case, however, banding, a relatively modern technique used to track migratory birds, resembles the more primitive technology of using homing pigeons to post messages, this time for family members who had become painfully excommunicated by Cold War geopolitics. This extraordinary story is symbolically powerful because it simultaneously denaturalizes human political boundaries and naturalizes kinship and nation, embodying the desire of so many Koreans like Dr. Won, who, as he told a newspaper in 1993, quote, are overwhelmingly envious of the birds that can overcome the wall of national division. The scientific achievements and the personal story of father and son ornithologists were duly integrated into both the ROK and DPRK propaganda machines and inspired a film in the 1990s co-produced by North Korea and Japan, and most recently an animated film co-produced by North and South. And this is just an image from a children's book, which I don't know if you can see very clearly, but there's barbed wire, 38th parallel, which divides the two Koreas, and the son crying in the south and the father reading, or with the bird in the north. And this is a commemorative stamp from North Korea that was printed following the elder one's death. Over the intervening decades, as political relations between the two regimes have remained stagnant and hopes of reunification have become increasingly dim, even for the most optimistic observers, the significance of the migratory birds that transect the DMZ have been scaled up in South Korea, both symbolically and materially, as state and market actors appropriate them in narratives of reconciliation for a nation divided for more than 60 years. In recent years, the majestic and iconic red-crowned crane has taken center stage, and spectacular images of endangered birds as airborne creatures that transcend terrestrial barriers and human obstacles has taken hold. Truly, avian migrations precede and supersede human political boundaries, yet the recent inflation of their cultural value cannot be understood outside of South Korean hypermodernity and what John Berger and Akira Lippitt identified as a tendency for animals to take on greater symbolic and commercial value with the disappearance of wildlife from humanity's habitat. That's Aki Lippitt. So these are just fake crane sculptures in this so-called eco dam in South Korea that was built in a red-crowned crane habitat, so that the water levels were actually drowning and destroying the feeding, the wintering habitat for these cranes. So as part of their interest in sort of at least in a PR sense counteracting that, they constructed these model cranes. Okay, so the bird I'm going to turn to in contrast to the anthropocentric representations of the red-crowned crane or starling C7655, I turn my attention to the ongoing research and conservation efforts of bird lovers whose practices and relations suggest how literally following the bird's lines of flight necessitates a spatial shift that is transnational and multidirectional. This spatial shift also entails a shift in social relations, from birds mediating patrilineal kinship and its restitution, to a more expansive network of human-avian connections that exceed nationalist imaginaries and statist agendas. I consider how visual technologies and mediated networks not only produce scientific data about birds and their trajectories, but also offer intersubjective openings onto avian perspectives in a world increasingly hostile to bird survival. So this is the black-faced spoonbill. It's a highly endangered species that breeds on uninhabited islands off the western coast of the Korean Peninsula. It was first observed in the 1960s by both elder and younger Dr. Wons on either side of the partition. It was designated as a natural monument by the South Korean government in 1968. I'm going to refer to it as the BFS. I'll just say that the English name is very unfortunate, but the Korean name is much more interesting. It's called jaose, which refers to the sort of whipping action that the bird uses with its beak, which is shaped like a spoon. In any case, I'll refer to it as the BFS from here on out. So the BFS once numbered around 10,000 at the turn of the last century, but by the 1980s, the first global census recorded less than 300. Through the transnational network of conservationists, including Dr. Won Byung-oh in South Korea, Park Yu-il of North Korea, Jung Jong-yeol, an ethnic Korean ornithologist in Japan, as well as conservationists in Vietnam, China, Taiwan, and Hong Kong. A conservation plan was formulated in 1995 under the auspices of BirdLife Asia. Through these efforts, the BFS was rescued from the brink of extinction with the most recent winter census of 2,725. So you can see how rapidly the population increased. The goal of BFS conservationists is to bring the total number back to the 1900 level of 10,000, yet the limited carrying capacity of existing breeding and wintering habitats makes this goal an unfeasible one, especially due to increasing destruction and threats to habitat, climate change, and pollution. Thus, although the BFS represents one of the great conservation success stories of the recent past, this success is under continuous threat of being short-lived. In contrast to the highly and readily iconicized and magnificent red-crowned crane, the BFS is a funny egret-like bird that is more curious-looking than exotic. It breeds, as I said, on the islands off the west coast of the Korean DMZ in the contested waters along the northern limit line, and travels to and from these islands to wintering sites in Taiwan, Hong Kong, Vietnam, and southeastern China. And I don't have a pointer, but the DMZ bisects the peninsula, and then the northern limit line refers to a very ambiguous border in the maritime area, and that has constantly been a source of tension and controversy, and also actual military conflict. Spoonbills prefer shallow waters of tidal flats and wetlands, where they stir the water and wait for fish and other marine organisms to pass by their rounded beaks. But these habitats have been under consistent threat from land reclamation projects in South Korea and across the Asian countries where the BFS winter and breed. In my larger project on the DMZ's nature, I critically analyze how the DMZ's ecological value is being produced in ways that reinforce and reproduce binaries between nature and culture, and argue that these conceptions are not only romanticizing and inapt, but also counterproductive to the larger goal of conservation and protection of the habitats and lives of actually existing endangered species. That the BFS used the western coast of the Korean Peninsula for its breeding grounds, especially the uninhabited islands of the disputed maritime borders, might reinforce the idea that pristine nature of the DMZ is indeed offering safe haven for these rare creatures. Hence the prevalent narrative that indulges in the notion that the DMZ is the ultimate paradox in being the most heavily militarized space in the world and also an ecological paradise that has returned to nature. I argue, however, that the DMZ is not unique, ironic, or paradoxical at all if one considers the ways in which, at a planetary level, capitalist development and the isolation of space through militarization are creating conditions in which it makes rational sense for the US Department of Defense to not only convert decommissioned Cold War sites into ecological preserves, but also to combine ecological preservation and research with military readiness. While conservation and militarization share is a need for spaces that can be protected from privatization, this accounts for why, at a moment when nature is being subsumed by capital in ever more intensified ways, the isolation of space by states in the name of national or global security is increasingly converging with issues of habitat conservation and biodiversity preservation in intriguing and problematic ways. And so that's how I frame the book project as a whole. So I locate the DMZ's nature and its objectification as a political environmental concern precisely at the nexus of these interrelated processes of capitalism, security, and conservation. In the ethnographic parts of this presentation, I focus on the work of ornithologist and conservationist Dr. Lee Gi-sup, who has been working for almost a decade to network with citizen ecologists, bird lovers, international organizations, and scientists to improve knowledge about and caring for endangered bird species. I offer two readings of Black-faced Spoonbills made possible by Dr. Lee, and in both I'm interested in interspecial relations of what Donna Haraway calls becoming with, quote, in contact zones where lines separating nature from culture have broken down, where encounters between Homo sapiens and other beings generate mutual ecologies and co-produce niches, end quote. These are also relations marked by asymmetrical power and embodied difference. I focus on low-tech and high-tech instruments that mediate the BFS as an object of scientific knowledge, which constitute what I call choreographies of endangerment, biopolitical modes relating to and recognizing non-human others that entail, even demand, the decentering of human perception. Animal studies scholar Matthew Trulu, in his incisive analysis of zoos and captive breeding projects, writes, quote, "The task remains to examine the biopolitics of endangered species preservation as a form of power knowledge devoted to making animals live, but nonetheless perilously bound up in the production of impairment and death." end quote. The focus of Trulu and others engaged with extinction is the problem of loving to death, creating ethically questionable conditions of suffering for individual creatures in ways that betray fundamental anthropocentrism. Trulu examines the zoo and captive breeding programs through the lens of their life, in which, quote, the biopolitics of endangered species preservation not only produces a bare life whose genetic unsuitability exposes it to death, it also produces a wounded life severed from the connectivities of emplaced kin and habitat, end quote. In the relations of conservationists and birds that I examine, sovereign relations over other than human life are organized very differently, around explicit interventions that seek to create flourishing life, not in the wild, but in natural cultural borderlands where maintaining connectivities to kin and habitat is a primary goal. Thus, in the biopolitical relations that I examine, conservation efforts are focused on what we might think of as nature as infrastructure, or what Foucault in his lectures calls milieu. For Foucault, security operates at the level of the population and requires the sovereign to, quote, exercise power at the point of connection where nature, in the sense of physical elements, interferes with nature in the sense of the human species, end quote. If conservationists are like the sovereign in Foucault's formulation, governing a population by acting on its milieu, this requires a biopolitical attention to the nature of the, in this case, non-human species, insofar, and this is quoting Foucault, it has a body and a soul, a physical and a moral existence. The militarized flyways that I'm interested in can thus be framed as hybrid natural-cultural milieus into which conservationists intervene. These flyways are infrastructural, that is, they are natural, cultural, and technical assemblages in which and through which conservationists labor to understand, regulate, and control the flow of migratory birds in order to ensure species survival. If infrastructure is often understood as humans' attempts to master nature, it is also about the naturalization of technological assemblages, and thus the impossibility of disentangling nature, culture, and techniques. The concept of the flyway refers to a scientific and conservation category in which avian cartographies intersect with human political ones. These are matters of concern for conservationists who have, since 2006, formalized flyways as describing geographic and biological networks that also include the social and political networks necessary to steward them on an international level. In this paper, I take avian flyways to be both models and enactments of networked relations between humans and avian others. They bring human activities and imaginations into contact with avian migrations, individual birds, and species or populations, and are in this way co-evolutionary. I hone in on these flyways as militarized, but also biological, social, political, infrastructural, and technologically mediated. In doing so, I seek to show how networked relations of bird lovers and birds across the flyway enact an interspecial poetics and modes of becoming with that may offer a compositional prospect for thinking and feeling our way along what Tom Van Duren calls the dull edge of extinction. So this is my first ethnographic scenario, I suppose. In 2011, I got to know ornithologist Gisup Lee, who is the president of both the Crane Network and the Waterbird Network in South Korea, and whose scientific and conservation networks extend to the other nations where migratory birds travel. I first met him through his work with the red-crowned crane, when I went to visit him in his office in downtown Seoul in May 2012, he was much more preoccupied by the BFS, which had recently arrived to the remote islands off the coast of the DMZ for the breeding season. Since 2006, he has been frequenting the islands off the western coast to monitor the BFS, and has brought Japanese and Taiwanese colleagues to Korea to observe the same birds that they monitor during the winter months. On this trip in May 2012, Dr. Lee's Taiwanese colleagues were unable to raise the funds to come. So I was able to go instead. Because it's very, you have to take a small boat to these islands, and so they can't bring up a huge number of people. So in a sort of somewhat unfortunate way, their inability to raise the funds made it possible for me to go. So I traveled with Dr. Lee and a South Korean environmental activist and two of Dr. Lee's research assistants from the port of Incheon in South Korea on a 2.5-hour ferry ride to Yeonpyeong Island. And I wish I had a pointer, but Yeonpyeong Island is the blue one, number 3. Oh, really? Okay.
Okay, it's number three, the big one. Right in the middle, yeah, that's the island. And then that tiny little dot, the other one, that is where we went.
That's the uninhabited island called Guji Island. So Yeonpyeong Island itself is in South Korean territory. It's 7.5 miles from the coast of North Korea and right next to the controversial northern limit line. It made international news in 2010 when it was battered by North Korean artillery in a training exercise, so-called, that led to one of the most serious skirmishes between the two Koreas since the 1953 armistice. And because of that barrage of artillery, two civilians and two South Korean soldiers died. So we took a ferry to, we took a ferry to that second largest island from here, 2.5 hours, and then we took a little boat to that tiny little island. There was little to no scientific knowledge about the BFS prior to the 1990s when conservationists first began to research its habitats and behaviors and monitor its migrations through radio transmission and banding methodologies. They were known to winter in Taiwan and in Hong Kong and were also seen on the western coast of the two Koreas. Over the course of the 1990s, land reclamation on the western coast of South Korea has led to the destruction of wetlands and tidal flats, most recently in the name of renewable energy and green urbanization, the most recent example of which is futuristic Songdo International City and Business Hub. And this is just showing you, obviously, how much the green areas, which would be the tidal flats, have been completely destroyed and built over. The effect on maritime ecologies has been profound and also on local fishing economies. Also in the late 1990s, BFS stopped showing up in their regular breeding areas along the coast of North Korea. The reason for this sudden disappearance, according to Dr. Lee, must have been a major disturbance. He speculates that this large-scale change occurred during the famine in North Korea, when starving people stole eggs from BFS and other birds' nests to sell in the black market or to consume themselves. Famine and habitat destruction thus contributed to the shift of BFS breeding grounds to the islands of the West Sea. So Guji Island, this is the view of Guji Island from the shore. And those are not BFS. Those are seagulls. There's a more particular name for them, but I'm not sure which particular species, but they're seagulls. So Guji was one such island that the BFS shifted their breeding grounds to, and its own political and ecological history is fascinating. In pre-modern times, it was central to the fishing economy, and its name was originally Kuojido, meaning place to seek out fish. After the war, because of its strategic location, it was converted to a South Korean military target range for air bombing drills. Sometime in the 1990s, however, it became a de facto preserve when a resident of the main Yeonpyeong Island transported 8 black goats there in an act of defiance. From what Dr. Lee told me, this person owned an inn on Yeonpyeong Island and felt that the disturbances from the military exercises detracted from his business. The island's colonization by the resident population of goats made it impossible for the military to continue using the island for training purposes. How the inn owner came up with this plan and how it was tolerated by the South Korean state, I have yet to verify. In any case, the goat stratagem worked, but created its own unexpected ecological outcomes. When we arrived on Guji Island, the detritus of artillery shells and other evidence of military presence, including a commemorative umbrella for the 60th anniversary of the Korean War, littered the shore. We saw the remains of bombing targets in the ground, marked by stones in a circular fashion. The goats, which are notorious for consuming any and all vegetation, including stripping bark from trees, had multiplied to 20 and had reduced the island's trees to scrawny stick figures poking out of the ground. Dr. Lee was not sanguine about the future sustainability of the island for the BFS, calling it a complete mess, ecologically speaking. The goats present no immediate threat to the BFS, but are consuming and killing off the organic nesting materials for the birds. White herons, which used to build nests in the trees of Guji Island, have already disappeared. Before departing from Seoul, Dr. Lee gave me precise instructions about what to wear and bring with me. The non-negotiable sartorial requirements were a camouflage or dark-colored waterproof jacket and a black umbrella. The reasons for the umbrella became immediately obvious once we landed. The seagulls were Hitchcockian in their vicious disdain for us, shit-bombing onto and nosediving into our umbrellas and violently pecking at our heads during our moments of weakened vigilance. But protection from the gulls didn't explain why the umbrellas had to be black. The reason I soon found out had to do with the fact that the goats wore black coats, and we were, to borrow opportunistically from Deleuze and Guattari, becoming goat in our quest to get close to the BFS nests. Becoming goat required us to hold the black umbrellas close to our crouched bodies, less like umbrellas than like military shields, while making our way in a single line incrementally, indeed very, very slowly, in a squatted position, up the hill to where the BFS nests were. And it was very, very slow. I can't really, it was like no theater or something. It was like so slow and arduous. Once there, we took pictures, counted the number of nests, pairs, and chicks. The banding that had been done in coordination with the network of BFS conservationists had helped to identify two birds, and we also saw a one-legged female who had been previously identified by researchers in Taiwan. Gucci Island, these are just pictures of one of the researchers being a goat. So I don't know if you can tell, he's all the way in the back over there. Sort of crouching to make his way very slow to the nests, which were like on the other side. And there he is. There's some of the BFS. Gucci Island, a militarized training ground in ecological dystopia, is a natural cultural borderland where BFS have found temporary safe haven in the narrow interstices of capital and militarization. Yet it is not only the BFS, but also Chinese fishermen who have located a space of illicit freedom in these contested waters. North and South Korean fishermen are prohibited from entering the waters between these islands and the North Korean coast, yet Chinese fishing vessels now regularly appear as overfishing has decimated fish populations in Chinese and other Korean waters. Dr. Lee feared that this activity would negatively affect the birds' food supply, but also that the fishermen might use the remote islands as resting areas and introduce new disturbances into these sanctuaries. Dr. Lee described to me the differences between the red-crowned crane and the BFS as a problem of interspecial intimacy. With the BFS, the ability to get close to them, observe at close hand their nurturing and feeding practices, especially with their chicks, helped to create an anthropomorphic identification as well as networks of shared knowledge and friendship. Yet what does anthropomorphic connection mean for someone like Dr. Lee, who described himself as someone who, quote, knew a lot about birds but nothing about people? For him, the BFS mediates a transnational network of BFS lovers that is an extension of the relations of friendship created with and through birds. This network, which has to overcome steep financial and political hurdles to meet in various parts of the region on a regular basis, has compiled an internet database with a detailed directory of banded birds and where they were seen in other parts of the region. And this is the website that has all the information of the banded birds. Naming the birds and being able to identify them in their migrations was another way to develop a sense of closeness to the birds and friendship among the human network. In contrast with the red-crowned crane, which breeds in the Amur region of Russia, in areas too remote and expensive to access, without the ability to share the same space and create an affect of intimacy, red-crowned cranes could be icons but not friends, according to Dr. Lee. So the BFS were seemingly much more tolerant of human company. Did that mean that our strange disguises and poor pantomime with our goat companions were effective? We were certainly more like wolves in sheep's clothing than the Yuka gear hunters of Rana Willislav's ethnography, who employ practices of mimetic empathy to get close to their prey. Perhaps the BFS saw right through us, but we nevertheless took cover under the goats. Performing goatness helped us to imagine the birds seeing us, granting us a bird's eye view, or a double perspective, to quote Wollerslev, in which, quote, an interspecies boundary is affected and some degree of union is experienced. This interspecies union, however, was triangulated. We needed the goats to get close to the spoonbills, and indeed we never encountered the goats themselves, only glimpsed them from a far distance, a bird's eye view, in fact, from the top of the ridge looking down into a small valley. Becoming goat to gain a bird's eye view was how we entered into the environment of the island through a process of corporeal dehumanization. Well before we were within viewing distance of the BFS nests, we began the process of becoming goat. And after moving on to other parts of the island, we continued in our painful and tedious goat-like movements until we finally took a break from the heat and dust to sit in a human space delimited by a large multicolored umbrella that Dr. Lee planted in the ground like a flag. Under the relative security of the umbrella, having shed our goat form, the black umbrellas, to sit under the human umbrella, I experienced a Schlatterdickian moment of realization. The umbrella was a sphere that made explicit the Umwelt, or extensive environment of avian shit, blood, dust, dead trees, and the incessant deafening cries of thousands of seagulls around us that we had hopefully stealthily passed through. In the near future, however, Guji Island may become a much more explicitly curated space of human-nonhuman design that will need to be actively managed in order to support the reproductive success of the BFS colonies. As he has done in the artificial eco islands of Songdo International City, an exemplary case of air-conditioned modernity and technologically designed nature culture, Dr. Lee and his assistants may bring in nesting material for the birds. And I'll take a break to just point out this. What you see is Songdo City, and this is a reservoir for the city. And right in the middle is one of these fake islands, an eco island, that has since become a BFS breeding ground. So Dr. Lee and his assistants, as they have done in Songdo, may in the future with Guji Island bring in nesting materials for the birds and may have to figure out ways to prevent the goats from consuming them before the birds learn how to use them. As he has done in other uninhabited islets, he and his colleagues may experiment with helping to build the nest themselves, configuring the birds' spaces like rooms in an apartment, co-constructing habitats and communicating with his partners in Taiwan, Hong Kong, and Vietnam to figure out where these birds will go as climate change alters their wintering sites and diverts their flight patterns. So this is where they literally are creating what he called rooms in an apartment for the birds to build their nests. So I'm going to shift my focus now to satellite tracking. And I start with a quote from Dr. Lee, who says, "I believe that the Earth is like an organism connected by a network. Through the birds, I've come to feel this very strongly." This was in one of our conversations, and this is how he tried to explain to me how the birds taught him about the flyway as a human-avian network. They connect tidal flats and wetlands across the East China and South China Seas. And as more knowledge of the birds' flyways has been generated through banding, bird watching, and especially satellite tracking, the movements of the birds created what Dr. Lee called organic linkages with other bird lovers along the flyway. As he said, if one part of the flyway is ruined, it will all be ruined. So local conservationists in all the related countries need to coordinate with their counterparts in other places. With these kinds of human connections and global governance issues in mind, the East Asian-Australasian flyway was formalized as a partnership in 2006 with the Secretariat based in Incheon, South Korea, and Dr. Lee is actually the current head of that. Since then, the Global Interflyway Network was formed as an attempt to coordinate conservation efforts across the world's 9 major flyways. A crucial yet expensive aspect of the conservation effort involves understanding in more detail the migration patterns of these birds. Therefore, in addition to banding and monitoring activities, Dr. Lee has raised money through individual donations and Hyundai Motor Company to fund the purchase of satellite transmitters to attach to some of the juveniles that fledged on the rocky islets and uninhabited islands that I just described. In this section, I ask how militarized flyways are also virtual flyways, mediated by GPS infrastructure and distributed across online platforms. Although some cultural analysis of satellite imaging and visual regimes of scientific knowledge production might frame the static representations of bird flight patterns as reductive or even violent, in the case of human BFS flyways, I found that they serve as the ground for interspecial empathy and critical anthropomorphism. This is a form of technobiopolitics that, like the critter cams attached to leatherback turtles, that Haraway sees as a fugal accompaniment rather than mere exploitation. And again, to quote Haraway, the animals, humans, and machines are all enmeshed in human hermeneutic labor and play by the material semiotic requirements of getting on together in specific life worlds. In this spirit, I follow the ways in which military surveillance technology may be put to the service of producing objective and totalizing knowledge of avian flyways, but also produce situated knowledges and stage affective relations through visual media that, I venture to say, is co-produced by birds and humans. In this section, I follow Dr. Lee's tracking of two individuals, Sung Young, E12, and Kaxi Hiro, E37. Both birds were captured and banded as juveniles and also outfitted with a backpack platform transmitter terminal, or PTT, satellite telemetry tracking device. In addition, the birds are given an identifier, which circulates in an irregular fashion across the human network, a nickname derived from the place of its birth, and a person associated with the network, or some combination of the two. For instance, Kaxi Hiro was named after the small islet in the Yellow Sea named Kaxi Am, where it was born, and then combined with the name of a Japanese colleague with the name Hiroyoshi. Sanyang was named after a Korean colleague of the same name, who helped to attach the PTT to the bird at its birthplace off of Yeongpyeong Island. So Sanyang is sort of Sanghyun, but that's the person's name, but it also can sound like the Yun of Yeongpyeong. So. If not already natural cultural assemblages, by the time they had been returned to their nests, the birds had become natural cultural technical ensembles par excellence, biotechnical companion species that were born into the contact zones of human avian flyways. I view these birds as life forms that are not only mediated by technological infrastructures and human networks, they also mediate the networks through their migratory movements, which are simultaneously technological and scientific inscriptions. In what's to come, I contrast the narrative discovery documented on the social media website where Dr. Lee posted updates about Sanyang with a scholarly article that resulted called New Perspectives on Habitat Selection by the Black-faced Spoonbill Platelea Minor based upon satellite telemetry, co-authored by 14 individuals, scientists with positions at universities in Japan, China, and the National Institute of Biological Research in South Korea. And Dr. Lee was listed as the fourth author on this article and the only person without a scholarly affiliation. Banding of the BFS has been ongoing since the 80s, and satellite telemetry using the Argos satellite system began in the late 1990s by Japanese ornithologists who confirmed that the islands off the DMZ were in fact important breeding grounds. Early technical difficulties related to the weight of the devices and their frequency of transmission have been addressed, but despite many improvements in the technology, PTT failures are still highly probable. And although the effects of the devices on individual birds' behavior and well-being is somewhat controversial and is a research subject unto itself, the importance of remote sensing through satellite technology is largely considered to outweigh the risks. As the website for North Star, a PTT manufacturing company, technocratically asserts, its products can, quote, turn tracking and monitoring into knowledge. The PTT devices work with software that decodes the satellite data and produces images that correspond to the coordinates relayed between the PTT and the satellite as the bird moves through space and time. The image itself is not indexical of the bird's movement precisely. It is an archive of the signals communicated between the device and the satellite. In the winter of 2010 and 11, Dr. Lee tracked Sanyang or E12's southward migration and posted his reports to the Water Bird Network's Down Cafe, a members-only social media site. Included were numerous shots of the Google Earth satellite images, such as this one, representing Sanyang E12's flight pattern based on transmissions received a couple times a day, every 2 days. These coordinates were connected as straight lines layered on a Google Earth background, offering what other scholars have critiqued as a view from nowhere, an authoritative panoptical image that empowers the visual consumer, but that disguises the process of image production and its historicity. Certainly, the lines that Sanyang E12 seems to be literally drawing on the globe need to be further scrutinized, not just as representations, but as a process of what Latour would call inscription. Quote, the types of transformations through which an entity becomes materialized into a sign, an archive, document, a piece of paper, a trace, end quote. Like the diagrams produced by the soil scientists he accompanied in Brazil, the satellite images are inherently contradictory. Latour writes, quote, it is not realistic. It does not resemble anything. It does more than resemble. It takes the place of the original situation, end quote. Keeping this in mind, I offer a close reading of the post by Dr. Lee in which a tension between the satellite image as inscription, literally a human-avian technological co-production, is an abstraction that purifies and simplifies the movements of this individual bird, taking the place of the original situation. Yet I point to how Dr. Lee's visual and textual narrative is not a mere transcription of the diagram, but a more complex engagement that draws attention to the inherent gap between the PTT's data points and the worldliness and idiosyncratic nature of Sangyeon E12. So I'm going to shift to my Evernote. And this is Dr. Lee's Down Cafe posting. The attack on Yeonpyeong Island by North Korean artillery mentioned earlier took place on November 23, 2010. This attack represented the most significant confrontation between the two Koreas since the armistice in 1953 and led to the evacuation of the island residents to the mainland. On this day, Dr. Lee reminisced about the day that they had attached the PTT to Sangyeon on Yeonpyeong Island, which was shortly after the Cheonan incident in March 2010, when a South Korean submarine was allegedly torpedoed by North Korea. He worried about whether the kind hosts of the inn where they stayed, who had been concerned about security on the island in light of the Cheonan incident, was doing okay. That day in March, they had named and tagged Sangyeon E12, who was 30 days old. And I'm just going to go through his posts and not do a lot of analysis until the end. These are the posts that Dr. Lee wrote, crafting a narrative of Sangyeon E12's winter migration. There are visual collages that include satellite tracking technologies, Google Earth, Google Earth's panoramia photo archive, and images taken by conservationists along the flyway. Receiving two or three coordinates every 2 days from the PTT, Dr. Lee could track Sangyeon's travel from late October when she started heading across the East Sea, 650 kilometers over a wide ocean, a dangerous first flight, in Dr. Lee's words. She traveled for 10 hours straight without rest, ending up in Yancheng, China, leading Dr. Lee to wonder whether there had been a strong tailwind helping her along. Having survived this first maiden voyage, Sangyeon just stayed just one day in Yancheng before heading farther south. As Dr. Lee wrote, on its way another 900 kilometers to Putian, she crossed over Shanghai. His textual accompaniment imagines the view of Sangyeon's from Sangyeon's perspective. He writes, quote, "A forest of huge buildings, countless Chinese villages and towns, the muddy waters of the Yangtze, and a huge 60-kilometer-wide lake, a world she never experienced in the Korean Peninsula." From Putian, the satellite transmission shows Sangyeon moving to, and this is one of the images that he took from Google Panoramia of Yancheng in China. From Putian, the satellite transmissions showed Sangyeon E12 moving to Haeyeon, and Dr. Lee posted this information to the network, the human network. Monitors from the Putian World Bird Society were on the lookout but couldn't find her. In the end, bird watchers in China were able to spot her and take a photo, this one, which they sent to Dr. Lee. He commented that Sangyeon looked healthy and was recognizably female, with a relatively more mature appearance. Sangyeon, however, was not finished with her travels. Having been photographed in China on November 6th, 2 days later she started moving back towards Hong Kong. But Dr. Lee's prediction was proven wrong. She bypassed Hong Kong and Macau and headed southwest. Why the hell would she do that, he wondered. When she was seen in Putian, she seemed to be traveling alone. One of her knees appeared to have been hurt from her long journey over the ocean. She seemed not to know where she was going. Dr. Lee speculated that she had no idea that there among the concentrated high-rise buildings in Hong Kong and Macau, there are hiding places for black-faced spoonbills. By the 10th, she had logged 1,000 kilometers and was heading past Hainan, where there were BFS habitats. She arrived in Vietnam. She arrived in Vietnam logging 2,000 kilometers in 3 days. But where she ended up in the Binh Tuan area was not a wintering site for BFS. It is a shrimp farm, a difficult place for birds to survive in. Without electricity or adequate food for the human inhabitants, it was a place where, given the opportunity, people might capture and kill wild birds to eat. Perhaps she did get something to eat or was chased away by the locals, but in any case, she moved on. Dr. Lee hoped that she would start heading north again towards an ecologically protected area that BFS used as a wintering spot. But E12 kept heading west to a place 40 kilometers south of Ho Chi Minh City. Dr. Lee worried that in this place with lots of small-scale fishermen, that Sangyeon might get caught up in a fishing net. And I think I went too far So he ended this travelogue with an emphatic request to the goddess of the Mekong River to have mercy, as he wrote, on Sun Yung, and help her to live. She, who at a mere 200 days old, had already traveled 4,000 kilometers. Other South Korean members of the group responded to his post, writing, "A truly long and difficult journey. Surely she won't be flying all by herself." And, quote, "Your heartfelt explanation of E-12's difficult journey. You've made my heart stop. I will join in your prayers for the grace of the Mekong." But this dramatic story was not over yet. In February 2011, Dr. Lee received correspondence from expat birdwatchers in Cambodia who had spotted four BFS in a crane reserve in Takeo province. According to the satellite, E-12 had been in Cambodia in January, but without active bird monitoring in Cambodia, it was difficult to verify the bird's well-being and existence. This heart-stopping journey was also a scholarly finding, as it had not been previously known that BFS traveled as far south as Cambodia. In 2013, a short communication was printed in Bird Conservation International, and having now been established as a scientific fact, the communication asserts the importance of satellite telemetry to the understanding of BFS habitat selection by presenting evidence of birds having wintered in inland freshwater areas as opposed to coastal areas where bird watchers often focus their monitoring activities. Especially in light of extensive land reclamation along the BFS flyways and the strange dip in BFS population census in 2011, the authors argue that monitoring should not overly emphasize coastal habitats to the neglect of potential inland areas being used by the species. So in the article, the objective basis of satellite telemetry is presented as generalized data, contrasted with a subjective bias of human monitoring. The satellite-tagged birds are identified only by their PTT serial numbers, and the wintering habitats mapped onto the East Asia region, according to zones. This scientific communique offers a point of contrast for understanding Dr. Lee's posts as part of the decentered choreography that I described earlier. His palimpsestic missives created a collage of interwoven texts and images that foreground their inherent instability and referentiality. It's less interesting to me that there's room for interpretation in the satellite inscriptions than that Dr. Lee attempts to fill in the gaps and how he does so. Between a strictly objective approach and an anthropocentric one, Dr. Lee's is a playfully anthropomorphic and fully engaged narration that privileges Sun Yung's agency and intentions, underscoring a fundamental uncertainty about what she is doing and why. There's certainly a theory of mind at play here and perhaps opportunities for a cross-cultural analysis of anthropomorphism across the East Asian countries. But what I focus on is the ways that the technobiopolitical assemblage of bird-human tracking device does not simply produce scientific knowledge as advertised by North Star, but also situated knowledges that project humility and love for an inherently unknowable other. I'm drawn especially to the subjunctive mood of Dr. Lee's posts, and what I would like to read is an interspecial poetics in which heterogeneous gazes, shifting scales, and multiple registers disrupt any attempt to create a coherent narrative. As aesthetic accomplishments, these posts foreground the hybrid nature of natural, cultural, technical assemblages that constitute avian migrations and human-avian relations. And I'll conclude with co-produced biography of Gakshi Hiro E-37, which provides a stark contrast with the story of Won Byung-ho and the starling C-7655 that I began the talk with. Dr. Lee provided a first report of Gakshi Hiro, who was banded and outfitted with a PTT backpack on July 1st, 2011. On August 24th, Dr. Lee posted a Google Earth image with surprising information. Gakshi Hiro had made a beeline north, traveling 260 kilometers to the shores of Gwagan County in North Korea. So the lower part is the South Korean area, and he went straight north. He wrote, quote, "I have no idea why Gakshi Hiro suddenly moved to that place in particular. It's Gakshi Hiro's parents' hometown. It's impossible to know to what extent Gakshi Hiro, having come of age in Gakshi Islet, decided to make this northerly stopover to return to his parents' hometown. However difficult it is to observe firsthand, meaning with the naked eye, as long as the satellite coordinates continuously transmit, it will be great from here on out if we can closely observe him." Dr. Lee reported Gakshi Hiro's flight southward to a wintering site in Taiwan, as well as his return trip, clocking in at 2,000 kilometers. After a brief stopover in Incheon, South Korea, he kept his northward movements to Haeju in North Korea, rather than returning to his hometown, Gakshi-an. Dr. Lee's final message read, quote, "For some reason, the crowded lights of South Korea didn't suit him. Maybe it's because he had previous experience going to North Korea. Even though he has headed to Jeju in North Korea, please welcome Kakshihiro E37 back home. Despite the tough weather, he succeeded in his migration. Kakshihiro is a hero. In contrast to the starling whose heroism was teleologically tied to overcoming the national division and reuniting father and son, here Kakshihiro crosses the border on his own trajectory with his own motivations, about which Dr. Lee can only speculate. Is it about avian kinship knowledge, territorial familiarity, or something else? The agency of Kakshihiro exceeds any nationalist or narrative frame, and his return to the North renders the political division irrelevant, not overcome. In South Korea, the existence of endangered species in and around the DMZ continues to underwrite the naturalization of kinship, ethnicity, and nation in contemporary narratives of Korean peninsular politics. Dr. Lee's biography of Kakshihiro E37 instead denaturalizes these human categories and is premised on a more than human logic in which the location and meaning of home is destabilized. We welcome Kakshihiro home, even as it is on the other side of the border, for it is not our home, but his chosen one. So in conclusion, multiple stresses on their habitats have brought BFS to the uninhabited islands off the DMZ, outposts of militarized nature. Birds' flyways may have always been subject to turbulence and disturbance, but the DMZ shows in extremis how the rapaciousness of capitalism, even in the name of sustainability, has rendered militarized spaces the most realistic refuges for endangered species of all kinds. For Dr. Lee and other bird lovers, celebrating our avian friends as symbols of freedom, transcendence, and reunification abandons them to a fantasy world of pure nature in which nothing will survive for very long. Yet there's another story of Guji Island and the other BFS and other BFS conservation efforts, that the migrations of birds open up passageways for exchange and cooperation, not between North and South Korean states and markets, but across the flyway, creating transnational networks of friendship, affinity, and care. In this rather provisional essay, I attempt to link the pathetic pantomime of humans in goat clothing and co-produce satellite biographies to the broader collective that constitutes BFS survival. Here, the hopeful narrative is not one describing lines of flight transcending the division, but one that hones in on ethical moments in which human vision is decentered through the poetics and pragmatics of interspecial mimicry and dehumanizing choreographies. These, in turn, are part of our alternative cartographies that monitor and trace flyways of endangerment, bringing humans and non-humans into urgent proximity and affectionate relationality. So I greatly appreciate your patience and willingness to travel with me and think through these ideas that are very much in formation. Throughout this project, I've struggled against prevalent narratives that look to the DMZ's paradoxical nature as inherently hopeful. I spent some time deconstructing those notions as indulgent romanticizations of nature and used ethnography to show how the focus on the DMZ's ecology has contributed to the erasure of political histories along the border and created more threats to actually existing biodiversity. Yet I was left dissatisfied, not only with the well-rehearsed critique of pure nature, but with the limitations of critique itself. Having burst the bubble of hope one too many times, I began to think about how the dialectic of hope and endangerment animates so many people's desires and imaginations, and sought to take seriously the hopeful but not naive ways in which people imagine different and more sustainable futures. This paper is an essay in that direction, and I dwell upon Dr. Lee's avian biographies because I see them as enacting a subjunctive and compositionist aesthetic in Latour's terms, material, mundane, imminent, realistic, and embodied, that seeks in some small way to compose a common world. Thank you. So I'm happy to take any questions or comments. I have more pictures I can show as well.
Not the goat, but
No, I haven't, in part because it's like brand new. And but I've been certainly thinking about it and thinking about, well, I wonder what Dr. Lee would make of this, you know. I mean, when he showed me his website and his, all of his things, he was very proud. You know, this wasn't like, oh, this is just this kind of slightly embarrassing thing that I do. He was really, you know, this is, and what I like about him is he really operates in all these different levels and all these different registers and discursive communities. And but yeah, I've been certainly thinking about what what he might make of it. So I'll have to see. I think. Sorry.
Thank you. excuse me. I just want to ask about the kind of what's the role of the actual birds in this? So I'll put a kind of skeptical case to you, which is that the very interesting responses to these birds are just human projections that could be projected on anything, right? But the birds don't really matter. I mean, I was sort of thinking about, for a non-natural example, like Mars rovers, which get people project all sorts of, you know, sort of family of man kind of things onto space probes, right? Like the comet landing.
Yeah.
People are all over the world are really into. Voyager had all this sort of family of man stuff on it, right? There's nothing natural there, but it could be just a projection screen just as easily for as a bird, or the kind of communitarian, non-national set of values.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess the question is, right, what is it about the birds in particular? Is there anything about the birds in particular that's really germane to the kind of political values that you're, you know, you want to touch on?
That's a great question. I one that I've been thinking about actually in, over the past couple of days in anticipation of coming here. But and you know, I had a research assistant in Korea who challenged me on this one because she was like, "I hate birds. Just like, why do we care about birds?" You know, and I was like, "Okay, I guess that's a good question. I mean, you know." And it, I think it relates to what you're saying. Like, right, it, you know, is it that in a social sense one can, you know, project one's affections or desires or what have you on anything, living or non? And yeah, of course. I think what I would like to argue makes a difference here is that, but it requires another level of commitment. You know, if one cares about species going extinct, which not everyone does, though I would argue that they should. You know, so it for me anyway, the, you know, what I find most interesting is, it has to start from that point, right? The care has to be situated around, you know, having an interest in diversity of all forms of life and their existence. So, it, you know, it doesn't really necessitate that one care exclusively about endangered species, but I think that that particular ethical stance towards the world is probably a precondition. So, yeah, so I'm just kind of thinking out loud right now, but I appreciate your provocation.
Yeah, did you, actually, this could somewhat follow up, because I wonder whether you've seen the documentary Tiger Spirit by UC.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And so that might be another parallel of an animal that is more literally legendary in Korea, has a greater deal of personal affinity and affection, which is with the, I don't know the name of the researcher who is actually looking for the recurrence of this tiger, goes into the some of these restricted areas. And so I don't know whether you saw either any parallels or that notion of this kind of recurrence of pestilence. In the case of Tiger Spirit, I think that search into the space was very much a desire to to reclaim what was lost, and so therefore that the reinscription of some of these, just the way, it's the way that the birds also, it's kind of transcending the border, but also going beyond. I mean, I thought that was one of the, in terms of the imaginary transcending, I think of the connection across these spaces. The other question I had, the one parallel that I saw most recently. And let me actually try to replay what I was about to say with the other part.
Yeah, so I have seen that film, and the person, what is his name? It's Ibom, I think. Im, his last name is Im. Anyway, so he's this former military guy who was obsessed with finding evidence of the apocryphal Siberian tiger in the DMZ area. And he's kind of gotten a lot of media attention because of this. But ecologically speaking, like, no one really takes him seriously. He's just this kind of maverick fellow who enjoys camping out. And he has one piece of evidence, which is like a tiger, something that looks like a tiger footprint in the snow. But I mean, what I would say is, yeah, I mean, there are people who, you know, there's a mythic element of that, certainly, right, of animals transcending political boundaries and being able to sort of, you know, having their own migratory paths and territories and things that exist despite human attempts to control national spaces. The difference I would say is that, you know, actually the conservation efforts that I'm interested in are literally trying to redraw maps according to flyways. And that doesn't mean that they imagined them to be transcending state power at all, right? But it's like that new that alternative cartography of the nine global flyways is kind of their blueprint for then how to engage with state entities that might help them govern these international flyways more effectively. So I'm really interested in how, like, one part of it is the interest in how flyways as a conservation concept is already a kind of social, natural, technical assemblage. They wouldn't think of it in those terms, obviously, right? But then how to actually understand and map those flyways in a more detailed way then requires the birds themselves to become these, like, you know, natural, cultural, technical assemblages, you know? And so so part of the effort is to denaturalize the idea that, you know, there's a tiger and he's living free at the DMZ or something like that, but also then to bring in what I think are useful alternatives for conceptualizing how spaces are, are also habitats, and then how spaces are political, and then how to understand them in ways that can help management, right? So because, you know, this is what conservationists would say anyway. It's like, you can't just leave nature, right? It needs to be managed. And so, you know, the management that Dr. Lee does in these places, like actually like make kind of half making a nest for them, you know, and kind of doing all this stuff, you know, it doesn't go against his own beliefs about how the natural world should exist, you know, though it might for others. And yeah, so
that actually leads into the other stuff, because you had mentioned kind of contact with the state. And I actually wonder if you could speak a little bit more about the militarized part of the militarized flyway, and whether there was any friction with the fact that they're operating in basically, as you said, these sort of maritime contested waters. They're using telemetry that, you know, even though they might take advantage of some military technologies, whether given that in the wake of the Yumping shelling and particularly China, I mean, this is an area that's very sensitive, and there's an investment in actually maintaining or drawing these lines. And so interactions or interference on the part of the military, or just whether in general there is any sort of contact or overlapping between, I mean, because your research and presentation is very much on ornithologists and conservationists, and I wonder whether either in your field work or in terms of their own interactions, to what extent they have to engage with or overcome some of the restrictions that might be placed because of the militarized nature of this?
Yeah, I mean, that was not really an issue, at least when I was there. But I think that, you know, as you know, like, things are so volatile that there, certainly in the other areas that I did some research, there were times when we weren't able to go because of military restrictions. And certainly on these islands, you know, if there's any, like, disputes going on, they would definitely probably just, you know, they would shut down the ferries going to Yunkin Island, for instance, you know. So, yeah, and, you know, it wasn't a matter of having to get permission or something. So it is kind of curious in the sense that, you know, the birds exist in this sort of interstitial space, and then the conservation ornithologist can sort of, like, go there too, you know. I should probably look more into that there may be other restrictions. But as far as I could tell, it really wasn't a factor.
I have, like, maybe a related question, which is, I was thinking about air and particularly about that sort of wonderful sort of bird, the Lutzermann, that the researcher tells about the bird's travel, and also about that image from the children's book and the way that it seems like a lot of what's at stake in the birds as a particular, I mean, not these particular birds, but birds themselves as a general category, is the ways in which airborneness transcends the arbitrariness, particularly of borders made by partition, right? Non-geological borders, non-ecological borders. But of course, one of the things that's happening now globally is the increased militarization of airspace, mm-hmm. right? Through drone technology in particular, and drone technology is itself taking advantage of the capacity for a bird's eye view, right?
Yeah.
So I was just sort of wondering too, like, whether or not, like, the sort of heuristic, cartographic, aesthetic, affective possibilities of airspace as a category get at all threatened by its instrumentalization by those kinds of military technology.
Yeah, I mean, actually, the very first version of this paper was conference paper that was for a panel called The Politics of Air, or Towards the Politics of Air or something. And so I kind of went into a whole thing about how, you know, the errors of the DMZ are not at all, you know, free from, you know, power lines. And, you know, I'm just to speak about that, the, you know, so I talked about all sorts of, like, missiles and missives that cross. You know, you may have heard of, like, the leaflets being scattered across the DMZ. And then they have, like, you know, for years they had huge loudspeakers blaring propaganda across the border. You know, they also have, like, huge lights that they'll light in case someone is trying to cross, walk across. Or, you know, so also, and, like, humongous, like, church crosses and, like, a massive statue of Mary, you know. So, like, there are all these things kind of, like, entering into the airspace. But more than that, I mean, when it comes to birds in particular, is there are tons of electric power lines. So those are actually, like, the biggest threat to the birds' freedom of movement. And so definitely I think that, you know, problematizing the airspaces as, you know, very political. And, you know, the problem that North and South Korea have is trying to maintain, it's not a no-fly zone, but they're trying to maintain security. So they have, like, some, I can't remember what it's called, like, some tactical positioning, where if any North Korean plane were to enter into the airspace, like, South Korean planes are ready to go within, like, 10 seconds. You know, so it's very secure. It's as securitized as they can make it, you know, and then it's also full of propaganda and all sorts of other things. So I hope that answers your question.
Yeah, I mean, my question in a way follows, I think, from Annie's. What's so really fascinating about this is to start to think about overlaying maps of flyways. I mean, it would be interesting to look at airline maps or maps of military surveillance or drone patterns as well. And part of what, so that's sort of one thing I think just to say is really fascinating about this. Another thing that happens in this project, which I think is really nice, is it it can work to kind of, let's say, deconstruct or whatever, at least challenge notions of borders and territory, as if territory is a kind of homogeneous space. And we put a line there, we've got a homogeneous North Korea and a homogeneous South Korea below that. Because in fact, what you've got is all this leakage.
Mm-hmm.
And it's more kind of network space. So there's all this effort put in to make sure humans don't cross, but then the bird can just fly, you know, to its own home on its own. But as you point out, the bird isn't just a natural bird, it's also got, you know, it's banded, and that band is, you know, can be tracked through tracking technology and mapping technology. So this is, I think, what, you know, another interesting way, I think, to take this is just to start, that it starts to, I think, allow you to maybe poke holes or to destabilize this notion of kind of, you know, homogeneous space and a kind of solid border. And I guess the last thing, just as a question, is I would imagine then that there are other species that one could do this with too, so that bugs must go across the border in the air. Fish must go, I would imagine, from the north and south, as well as other critters too. Is there work done on any of that, or do you have any interest in expanding your work in that direction in terms of other species?
I was going to say bugs go. No. I don't, I mean, you know, the most famous bug person in anthropology is Hugh Raffles, but, and he has talked about air as like a multi-species realm. But I would imagine it would fit more with Gloria's interest in, you know, how pathogens travel and, you know, that kind of thing. But I don't really know of other research. I can just say sort of empirically that, you know, fish for the Korean border area is the source of a lot of the conflict around the northern mainland. It's all about fishing rights, who gets the fish. And they're so constrained from where they can go, and there's so much overfishing. So that's where a lot of these conflicts are coming from. But to your first point, I that's another aspect that I have been really interested in, and the most obvious ways in which, you know, these maps overlay, but also kind of like collide, is like bird strikes on planes. Right? That happens, you know. And now there's actually satellite tracking being used to avoid those bird strikes. So, you know, there are interesting ways in which other people are thinking about how these overlap, because the skies are very crowded. They're incredibly crowded, and with waves of all kinds of, you know, and objects and things. So, but I do think that there's a tendency not only to see air as transcendent and kind of like a passageway of freedom, but also as, you know, isolating particular things that move and not seeing them as part of this kind of airy ecology where there are lots of things kind of on collision courses.
And also, I might have missed this, is there any ornithology in the north going on? So are there is there any cooperation that happens?
There's really only, as far as I know, one ornithologist, Hakyu, and he does everything. I mean, of course, there's like the state-run National Science Institute. And the North Korean government, you know, proclaims an interest in the natural world and ecology and also environmentalism. And so there are, you know, particular species that have been designated as natural monuments and all those. You know, so they're hooked into that. But as we all know, it's, you know, I mean, North Korea was like ranked last in like an international survey of sustainability. So in the world, so out of like 160 countries or something.
Mm-hmm. Do we have time for that? I guess I just want to bring it back out to something, I guess, the former project. And I'd like to take it to the level, I guess, of cultural narrative. And just having had the opportunity to talk at greater length with you about other aspects of the
film. I'm sorry to interrupt. You turn towards the back a little.
Oh, sure. You can see me becoming ghost myself. Having had the opportunity to talk with you about the larger project and various manifestations, this seems, I'm surprised because a lot of the, at least from the last time we spoke, a lot of the project centered around, I guess, certain kinds of failures, right? And there is a kind of element of hope here that was surprising to me, but I wondered if you could talk about that in relationship. You know, we have these kinds of suspended and forever suspended failures of, let's say, the biodiversity projects or the reunification projects, like those that exist in the suspended hope and failure type of thing, right? This one is far more optimistic, and I was wondering if you could talk about that, just the cultural narrative or the cultural feeling of that kind of optimism in this project, very much about encrusted with failure. Did you hear that?
Well, I guess sort of, I mean, one thing I was trying to get at, some of it comes out of the fact that I found myself in conversations with people about the DMZ who were like, that's so great, that's so cool, that's so wonderful that the birds, you know, connect the two Koreas and transcend, you know, like they're really into that narrative. Yeah. And I constantly found myself being like, no, it's not really like that. And I was just like the bubble burster constantly, right, like pricking away. But I didn't really have anything more to say beyond like, it's really much more complicated, and actually, you know, what's going on with the DMZ is actually making life worse for a lot of different creatures, you know, and environments. And I would say that like this paper is moving towards a more hopeful thing, in the sense that I suggest in this kind of compositionist way, right? How can we kind of put, you know, things together in unexpected, sort of drawing attention to the seams and the gaps and kind of, you know, looking for possibilities that, I don't know, it just sounds so cliche, like thinking outside the box, you know, but you know, sort of taking seriously some of the work that's being done that might look like failure, right? It's like the last DFS census, there's one additional bird since last year. It's like, what's going on? And so there's a lot of reason to despair when it comes to conservation and endangerment, certainly. But you know, the people, I mean, Dr. Lee and other people, like they're really, you know, they have a certain commitment. I think some of it is fueled by this sort of cultural activity, right? Obviously the conservation activities, but the sort of constructing of these narratives and things. So that's really my endeavor. I don't know that I am fully like giving up on the cynical and, you know, kind of negative story about the DMZ, but in any case, you know, I'm trying to at least give the discourses and, you know, the discourses of hope that are so prevalent, some of the do regard that they might deserve, so.
Yeah, I guess I was saying that they seem to interlock in a way that's far more interesting than just, you know, but the choosing,
oh, definitely,
the hope and the
yes,
failure,
yes,
so
yes,
interestingly interlocked here, and
yeah,
here it's more pronounced.
Yeah. I mean, one could argue that, you know, the whole attempt at reunification is such a massive failure, mm-hmm, that that's exactly when the DMZ suddenly is just glommed onto, yeah, as like this hopeful thing, because it's the DMZ as an ecological preserve itself is kind of an impossibility, I think. But that's, you know, for all these policymakers whose job it is to like keep coming up with new policies. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're all over this. Not the birds, but the DMZ as a
right,
as a preserve, because, you know, what else do they have to work with?
Yeah.
You know, they have no idea what's going on in North Korea.
Right. So to be clear, it wasn't like, why are you suddenly so hopeful? Which, you know, does alarm me, but that's beside the point. So it was to
no,
say that
still
there's
dark,
something really interesting for me in that. That's really present here in the hope, in the failure. I can't think of another word.
Yeah.
All right.
Thank you
Thanks.
Very much.